This is Warrior Kid podcast number 25, Ask Uncle Jake. This podcast is based on the three Way of the Warrior Kid books. The first one, Wimpy to Warrior, The Navy SEAL Way. The second one, Mark's Mission. And now, the third book in the series, Where There's a Will. The books are about young Mark, who faces a lot of the problems that kids everywhere face. But Mark gets help solving those problems from his Uncle Jake, who is a Navy SEAL, and who stays with Mark in the summertime. This podcast is for kids to hear some more lessons from Uncle Jake and also get the chance to ask Uncle Jake questions. But today, we actually have a special guest on the podcast. His name is Jon Bozak, and he is the artist that did all the illustrations for the Warrior Kid books and for the book Mikey and the Dragons. Jon and I were friends growing up, and when I wrote Way of the Warrior Kid, I reached out to Jon because he was the best artist I ever knew, and I asked him if he would draw the books for me, and he did. So, Jon, welcome to the podcast.
Thanks for having me.
So, I want to ask you a couple questions. The first one is, when did you start drawing?
I'm unsure because it was a long, long time ago, but I'm sure it was as soon as I could hold a pencil.
So right away, you liked drawing?
Right away.
Were you good at it when you started?
My parents thought so. I don't think it's till I got into school and other teachers and kids were telling me I was good that I started to realize, yeah, I'm pretty good at this.
What do you think made you good?
Oh, it was a combination of things, but one of it is practice. You know, I had a talent, but unless I practiced it, I wasn't going to get any better. So I just kept drawing.
How much did you draw?
All the time. I drew when I was lying down in front of the TV. I mean, I didn't draw during dinner, but I drew during, say, school. We had a time called free hour. And so you could do whatever you want. The teacher would let you do whatever you want for an hour, and I would draw. And I had a group of kids who also drew, and we would just draw for an hour.
What would you usually draw?
A lot of things. I love drawing cars, motorcycles. I would come up with spaceships and people and faces.
What's the hardest thing to draw?
Hands. I find hands to be really, well, feet. Feet and hands are tough.
What is it that makes them hard?
They, you know, hands and feet kind of have to have an expression to them. And, you know, every finger's different. So you're dealing with five fingers on a hand doing something. And it's just tough to kind of get it right. If I knew, I probably would get it right.
So when you're drawing, when you draw something, does every drawing that you do, does it look the way that you want it to look the very first time you draw it?
I would say 99% of the time, no, not at all.
So what you have in your head isn't what comes out on the paper the first time?
Never. Like 99% of the time, not.
How so when I was a kid, and you remember, I used to draw too. Uh-huh. I was not as good at drawing as you. I also didn't practice as much as you. But it seemed like a lot of times when I would draw something and it wouldn't look the way I wanted it, I would just get frustrated and mad and give up on it.
Yeah.
Is that the right thing to do?
No, that's not the right thing to do. Here's the thing. Like, I remember when we had that free hour, right? There's this kid, Lenny, and he would draw, right? We'd all draw. And every time, like halfway through, never fail, he would get mad, he'd scribble in the drawing, he'd crumple it up, he'd throw it across the room and just yell, "You stink." And that's not how you approach the whole problem, right? For me, I would get frustrated too, because you want to draw something, especially when you're younger, you want to draw something that's really good. So I would just practice and just try it. If I didn't get it right the first time, I would learn from what, you know, I did that didn't work. Why was that nose so big? What did I do that made that nose so big? And just sort of apply that information to the next drawing and just practice. And keep my cool.
But is there anything that you did to make sure you didn't get mad while you were drawing something?
Well, I would think about all the artists out there who did really good drawings, and they're not getting mad, right? And I want to reach those goals. You know, there's a kid in my school called Bob Ackerman, and he was like 50 times better than me. And I was kind of jealous. And I basically went up to him and asked him how he did what he did so well. And, you know, that's not getting frustrated. That's sort of finding a solution. So I tried that. I would just try to ask other people who are good, how do you do that? and then learn and try to do it with my drawing so I would get better and be happier.
I remember you taught me technique.
Right.
I was drawing a picture one time. I was drawing a face. And you said, hey, you're making these lines straight.
Yeah.
It was like the wrinkles around his eyes or something of an older man.
Yep.
And I was just drawing the lines straight. And you said, hey, that part of the face is curved, so those lines should curve.
Sure.
And I drew it again, and then it looked a little bit better.
Yeah.
And what I realize now looking back is that just like everything else that you want to do, that you want to get good at, for me, jiu-jitsu, right? Jiu-jitsu is something where you learn these little tricks, these little techniques. Oh, you need to move your hips over here. Oh, you need to grab the wrist over there. And when you make these little adjustments, all of a sudden it makes the move work and you eventually get better. And it seems like when I look back now for drawing, you learn these techniques and what you just told me, that you would ask someone that was better than you, hey, how do you do that?
Yep.
And then they tell you what technique they used. Yeah. And then you practice that technique until you get good at it. Then you see another technique or you see another thing that you weren't able to do. You say, hey, how did you do that? And you start applying that technique. Yep.
I call it pivoting, right? You change direction. If something's not working, you ask yourself, why isn't it working? And you try something different. You know, for that technique I was telling you about, you know, I realized that the face is curved. I looked at other drawings that, like, you know, let's say in a museum or in books or comic books, and those lines were curved. I'm like, oh, because it sounds like they're sculpting the shape. They're going around the cheekbone with the pencil, right? They're making lines like as if they're going around the cheekbone. And you know, you just learn, and you got to keep changing. You got to keep trying new things.
Now, I was amazed when I called you up for the first time and said, "Hey, I wrote a kid's book. Will you do the illustrations?" And you said, "Well, you know," and you were busy. You know, you work and all that stuff. And you said, "Well, you tell me the story." So I told you the story, and you said, "Oh, that sounds awesome." And you said something like, "Hey, give me 15 minutes. Let me call you back." And, you know, I had told you the whole story. I told you about Mark. I told you about Kenny Williamson. And about 15 minutes later, you sent me a picture just on your phone. You just texted me a picture, and it was of Mark.
Yep.
And it was perfect. It was like exactly what I had in my head for Mark. When you drew Mark for the first time, what did you base that character on? You just knew the story. You hadn't read the book. Yeah. You just knew the story. What did you base it on?
It was on me because I identified with Mark's character. I mean, as a kid, as a child, I went through the same problems. And so it was pretty easy. I mean, I was just like, this kid is like me. And then, you know, it's a pretty straightforward, imagination to paper right there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then when you're drawing a character, what do you think of that you're going to make the character look like? Is it always based on someone that you actually know?
Yes, most of the time, yeah. It could be somebody I know directly, or maybe that character reminds me of somebody I saw in a movie. But it's based on a thing, a person, a character. And sometimes it's real personal, and sometimes it's something that somebody else came up with. I'm like, oh man, that sounds like that guy. Like Kenny Williamson actually reminds me of a kid, I won't name him, but a kid who was in my class from like first grade all the way through. Actually, he graduated with me.
Okay. So that means I know him too.
You do. I'll tell you later. But yeah, I mean, he just did. He had that same energy, or I should say I modeled Kenny's energy and look after that kid.
Yeah, and that was the second, again, you sent me the picture of Mark, and I said, oh, that's awesome. That's perfect. That's exactly what I had in my head. That was the crazy thing.
Yeah.
I think that's because we've known each other and been friends for a long time, that what I was thinking and what I described, you knew and you drew. Then 15 minutes later, you send me Kenny Williamson.
Yeah.
And I just couldn't believe that you nailed Kenny Williamson, and it was perfect.
Well, yeah. The bad guy's sometimes fun to draw, too, because, you know, he's the guy who's breaking the rules, and he has, like, a, you know, a look that's very easy to kind of establish and create, and it's fun.
Now, where we had a little bit of melding of the minds was in Warrior Kid 2, Mark's Mission, Nathan James.
Yeah.
Because... Yeah. I told you who Nathan James was in real life. Nathan James was one of our other friends, and that was kind of who I based the character on. Was that character Nathan James was based on our friend, and you knew that.
Yep.
And you nailed that one,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, that was fun. That was a lot of fun. And you know, it's every time you do I do a drawing, I think it's similar for other creatives. You don't know if you're going to get it or not, right? Like I said, you can fail. And I know from history that 99% of the time, my drawings don't come out the way I want them to look. But they can sometimes get something completely right. And that's something you can't predict. You don't even know what it is. But with Nathan, yeah, I was like, he's going to love this. I can't wait to send it.
That was a good one. And what about Uncle Jake?
Well, Uncle Jake was pretty easy. I modeled him after you. Yeah.
But you gave him hair, more hair.
I didn't want him to look exactly like you. And it's a little more fun to draw a character with hair.
Oh, that makes it
it's a challenge
better
too.
To look at?
It just makes it something, it makes it more a funner journey, if you will, to making the drawing. You know, every drawing is kind of a journey too, because you're learning along the way. Every drawing I do, you know, if it's the same character over and over again, one, you want to kind of make it look just a little bit different, make it unique, make it interesting for yourself and for the viewer. So hair can be, hair is difficult too, by the way. Hair and hands and feet are not easy. And so I just kind of want to put the challenge to myself.
And you're in Warrior Kid 3, you're starting to get a little bit more detailed in some of the drawings.
Absolutely. That's right. You know, everyone's getting a little bit older. Mark's getting a little bit older. And, you know, and Uncle Jake has always been a little bit more detailed than the other characters because he's older. So I'm trying to kind of create a thread there where as the books go along, things get a little more detailed, maybe a little bit more realistic, which is, again, kind of fun to do because it's a challenge.
Yeah. And then the other one that we did together is Mikey and the Dragons.
Yeah. I love that book.
So do I. This is another good one. I said, hey, I got another project I'm working on. And did I send it to you? Yes, I sent it to you. I sent it to you in one shot. I said, hey, here's a new book. If you think you can make time to draw it.
Man.
It probably takes 12 minutes to read that.
Yeah.
12 minutes and 15 seconds after I emailed you the thing, you said, I'm drawing this.
Yeah,
on it right now.
Yeah, absolutely. I was not going to let that go. I mean, I don't care what I had to do to make sure I was able to do that. I was going to make it happen.
And Mikey, where did that character, with the look of Mikey in Mikey and the Dragons, where'd you develop that look from?
You know, I took that from as a kid. Oh, that's such a good looking book. I took that from, as a kid, all the stories I read about young, like little warriors, right? Who had to rise to like meet their challenges, right? They had to become heroes. I pulled it from all the books that it's inspired me. So a lot of different characters.
What comic books did you read and like when you were a kid?
Ooh, I liked a lot of superhero ones. I mean, the Hulk, X-Men. I loved, there's one artist, his name was Jon Byrne, B-Y-R-N-E, and just the way he drew fists and like superheroes and muscles, it was just awesome. Another one, my main inspiration though, now remembering, Snoopy.
Oh.
Charles Schulz, Snoopy, I just loved that comic strip. I would draw Snoopy all the time. And that's another thing too, I'd sit down and I would just find a picture of Snoopy or Charlie Brown that I really liked, and I would try to draw exactly as I saw in the book. And that was good because it helped me sort of deconstruct what I was looking at. How's that drawn? How's it made? What are they doing with the lines? Now, I didn't understand all that when I was like a little kid, and I still don't understand all of it now because I'm still learning as an artist. But back then, I was just like, how can I make it exactly like I see it? And it kind of creates a really good skill set.
How many times would you draw Snoopy in a row to try and match what you saw?
Oh, a dozen times.
12 times,
yeah,
15
absolutely.
Times.
Yeah, every. I mean, it varied because sometimes I'd get things close and sometimes, and also sometimes I'd move on to another drawing. I'm like, all right. As I got older, I learned sometimes if you can't get it right, step away and return to it because you'll have a fresh mind. You won't be worn out. You'll see it better. You'll see sort of the subject matter more clearly. Because listen, even if you deal with the frustration, you still are frustrated a little bit. And sometimes it does build up and the best thing is to detach. Kind of step away and then return to it when the timing is better. And then that's kind of like, it's like you approach it with a completely fresh set of eyes.
Mm-hmm. Something you were telling me about yesterday as well when we were talking was at looking at things from a different angle, which is similar to what you just said. And I know for me, when it comes to problem solving in life, one of the best things that you can do as a person is when you have a problem and you're only looking at it from one angle, you need to try and see it from a different perspective, see it from another place. And then sometimes that allows you to see a solution that you couldn't see from your original angle.
100% correct. I mean, I remember when I was in art school, I was in a drawing class, I think it was sophomore year in college, and a teacher told us our assignment for the week, it was a weekly class, was to draw one object as many times as you could. He says, I don't care if you draw it 100 times. Draw, like, don't come in here with like 6 drawings. Come in here with dozens of drawings. So I picked, and he said, pick something random. Don't pick something like obvious. So I picked a slice of pecan pie. I loved pecan pie back then. And
do you
so
not love pecan pie anymore?
I do, but I don't eat it like I used to. And but I'm telling you, once you get to like 20 drawings, you are looking at it in a completely different way because you've already looked at it the most obvious ways, and you've already drawn it the most obvious ways. Now you're just opening up to experimentation, and you're getting crazy with it. And it's really freeing. And that teaches you that sometimes maybe you shouldn't take until the 50th drawing or the 30th drawing to get crazy with it. Maybe you should try that in the first drawing and see where you're at. So very interesting exercise.
So you would draw it really close.
Absolutely.
And then draw it far away.
I draw like the slice, you know, the pick, like maybe from the side. And that was the first shot, like right on a plate. And then I just got nutty, like no pun intended. Like really, I'd be drawn just a pecan piece at, you know, like by the end, just to like really get abstract.
Ultra detail?
It varied. Sometimes I'm like, be super detailed. And other times it'd just be super loose. And like, you wouldn't know what it was unless I told you, you know what I mean? But it would still look kind of cool.
How many did you end up drawing?
I don't remember because it was a long time ago, but I know it was at least 30.
What is a big challenge that you faced as an artist that you had to overcome? A lot of, you know, kids that listen to this podcast all face all kinds of different challenges. Yep. And, you know, I think when you said earlier that you kind of based the way that Mark looked on yourself because you related to Mark, I think that every kid, I think that's why the book, kids like the book a lot, because every kid has problems, and they might not be the same problem. It might not be that they can't do pull-ups or can't swim or are getting bullied or don't know their times tables, but they'll have different problems. And that, I think that's what the book's really good for teaching, is how do you overcome these problems? Mm-hmm. You don't back away from them. You go forward and you figure them out. What's a challenge that you had to work through in your life?
It's a good one. You know, for me, I've drawn my whole life, or I've been creative my whole life. You know, as a kid, I used to draw all the time. My mom and I would like go shopping, right, for groceries or clothing or whatever for the family. I would sit, you know, while she's shopping and imagine like maybe a movie scene that I was a director of. Always imagining, always creating. I'd go to my uncles and aunts. I would kind of grab a Wheaties box and maybe a toilet paper roll and make, you know, weapons out of it or armor. Always doing things. Thing is, no one was managing me or watching me or telling me, hey, you got to get that done in 15 minutes or 2 days, right? I just did what I wanted to do and created freely. Well, once I decided I wanted to have a career as an artist or a creative, suddenly somebody's paying me, right? Somebody is hiring me to do a job, you know, whether it's designing a logo or building a website or, you know, drawing characters, and you have to do it under a deadline. And you're getting paid. And I was slow because my whole life, I was always like, you know, just sort of like staring at the clouds and daydreaming and imagining things. And that doesn't cut it when you're getting paid. I mean, listen, it does, but you want a raise, you want a promotion, you want to like beat the competition, you know, because listen, you're working for somebody, you're up against, you know, challenges of a business. So I had to learn how to manage my time. I didn't even know what time management was. And I had to be efficient. And so for me, it was the only way I could do that is something like Uncle Jake talks about all the time, right? Self-discipline. I had to start to dial myself in. I had to start sacrificing, waking up earlier so I could work longer in a day because I wasn't fast enough. Then I started putting in like alarms, putting my own deadlines. So let's just say I had to design like 5 logos that week and I'd be done by the end of the week. Well, day one, I would make sure that at noon, I had, for lunchtime, I had the outline of the logo number one done. By the end of the day, that first logo had to be finished. And so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. So every day, you just create these sort of deadlines you have to self-impose. And that really helped me learn how to get faster. And also not fall in love with the details and learn to just make things good, but not perfect. And just be quick and get things done. And you know what? In the end, over time, I got things done on time, and my, you know, talent or my ability made sure things still came out great. Mm-hmm. And it's something I still, you know, I still have to manage every day, because it is very easy as a creative, or at least for me, to start to kind of wander and daydream. And I have to make sure I'm dialed in and I maintain self-discipline to be focused. And it feels good because you get work done. People are happy.
Yeah, it was incredible, the timeline that you drew and colored Mikey and the Dragons. I mean, you did that in a rapid amount of time. I don't think anyone else could have done that.
Oh, thanks.
To do it that quickly on that kind of turn time and to have it come out perfect.
Thanks. It was listen, that was a great experience. It felt like a little bit like college. You know, it was long hours. I mean, I was putting the time in because I'd rather have that be beautiful and lose the sleep than have it be okay and get the rest.
You know, you mentioned reading comic books
yeah.
as a kid, and I was not into comics as you were. There's definitely a few comic books that I liked, but when I see movies now, like the big comic book movies, I'm not really too into them at all. Are you?
I'm actually not.
Yeah, me neither.
They don't really do anything for me.
Do you think that there's something that you lose when you just get the whole story fed to you 100%?
Absolutely. I mean, I remember even with comic books when I was a kid, you know, comic books are pretty basic as far as storyline. You're looking at, I don't know, 30 pages and, you know, and maybe because I'm a creative-minded person, I would go through them slowly and I would sort of fill in any gaps. I would imagine things beyond that. And again, remember when I mentioned that me and my mom, you know, we should go shopping, I'd go hang out and like sit down. And I would imagine parts of the storyline that didn't exist in the comic with those characters because it inspired me or sparked an idea, right? So I think when you're reading something or you have less of a story or less information and you can let your mind run with details that you come up with, it's fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What are you working on now? What do you got going on?
Well, we got some amazing Mikey and the Dragons and Way the Warrior posters that are happening. I'm really excited about. I think they're going to do really well. I think people are really psyched. We got the Warrior Kid Code poster coming out that I'm in love with. we got a Mikey and Dragons one that's really, really awesome. And then also starting to work on a Warrior Kid coloring book, which is going to be awesome.
You showed me some of those pictures. Those are great. And what I think is going to be nice about that, too, is we're breaking down the story a little bit simplified for maybe even a little bit younger age. So I think kids that are at the coloring book age will be able to read the story and have a better comprehension, maybe even read it on their own, even at a younger age than Warrior Kid is meant for. So I think that's going to turn out to be really good.
I hope so, man. Yeah. That's the goal.
Well, thanks. Well, thanks for doing all the artwork you've done.
Thanks,
and
man.
Bringing these characters to life on the page. It's been awesome to work with you again after knowing you for all these years and finally to do a project and now do multiple projects and continue to do these projects. And I know all the kids out there, thank you for doing it as well.
It's a pleasure.
And thanks for coming on.
You got it, man. Thanks, Jocko.
And that is all we have for the Warrior Kid podcast this time. And if you want to get one of these Warrior Kid books, you can get them at warriorkid.com. And you can also get the Warrior Kid books and you can get Mikey and the Dragons from amazon.com. And if you want a Warrior Kid t-shirt or a Warrior Kid rash guard, you can get them at jockostore.com. And if you start jiu-jitsu and you need a jiu-jitsu gi for kids, you can get one at originmain.com. You can also get Warrior Kid Mulk protein mix that tastes absolutely delicious and it makes you stronger and healthier. And you can also get that at originmain.com. And also, if you want a Warrior Kid picture for your wall or you want a Mikey and the Dragons picture for your wall, we're just putting those out. They're from flipsidecanvas.com. So go on there and pick out the one that you want. And that is it. And thanks for listening. Thanks for reading the books. And remember what Jon Bozak said about how you can get better at things. And that is by practicing and challenging yourself to do the best work you possibly can do. Now go out there, train hard, study hard, work hard, get after it, and be a warrior kid.